So I'm Julie Crawshaw, and I'd just like to start by saying I'm really, really pleased to have been invited and be included in this dialogue. I've been involved with artist-led practice and self-organised work since 1994. So it's really just great to be able to contribute to the development of that discourse and sort of global conversation. So I've been invited here today as a co-investigator of stretched, expanding notions of artistic practice through artist-led cultures at Valland Academy, which Jason E. Bowman will speak more expansively about tomorrow. My involvement with that project as a researcher is as an anthropologist. My route to anthropology is born out of a sort of interdisciplinary pathway through beginning in fine art practice in drawing and painting, with a particular investment in artist-led project development, then moving to development studies, and then to planning, where I was supervised and examined by anthropologists. And my interest there was to develop a dialogue between artistic practice and the way that art is discussed and framed in urban discourses. So kind of interesting to me, the sort of segue towards regeneration in the panel discussion this morning. So my research is informed by the premise that we can learn with art practice, and as such I describe my work as anthropology with art, as a dialogue between modes of inquiry. So at this point, perhaps to say that I'm have been sort of regarded as like a cat in a basket, so somebody who constantly is clawing at blankets to look for places to sit down, and I guess I'm sitting in anthropology as a dialogue, as a dialogic practice, and for that reason I feel comfortable there. So I'm not, as you can see, kind of disciplinary. I feel uncomfortable in kind of disciplinary kind of boxes maybe, because I'm directed by a, I suppose, an inquiry, an interest, and that is, I'm sort of led by an interest in the support of livability, or in support of livability, I explore how we are connected. And my fieldwork has been in UK development contexts of urban regeneration, island governance, and UK community development contexts. However, today I'm going to talk about Midwest, which was a six-year UK project that I co-directed with Jason E. Bowman and Rachel Bradley. And shaped by our focus of the commons today, I'm going to first introduce the Midwest programme as it developed during 2002 to 2008, and then I'm going to return to visit the Midwest landscape. So I think what I'm doing today is a sort of a thought experiment, or an experiment in thinking around notions of artistic practice through artist-led cultures. So as a project that finished 7 years ago, Midwest has become part of a personal archive. My story of Midwest today is built from my personal partial recollections of what took place, alongside reports, pamphlets, and other paraphernalia that now live in boxes. So in 2002, Arts Council England, West Midlands, at that time the Arts Council in England was divided into sort of regional offices, circulated a tender to support the visual arts landscape of the West Midlands region. It was called the Shaper Scheme for Artists. The aim of the call was to support the development of practice hotspots across the West Midlands region of the UK, alongside, alongside a number of sort of smaller cities and also rural areas, the West Midlands region of the UK includes Birmingham, which is England's second city. So Arts Council England distributes central government funds in support of the arts, and when we were interviewed, or after the interview, I think maybe, the Arts Council officers told us that they were struggling with how to support visual arts provision in the West Midlands. They had supported visual arts agencies and galleries before, but they had not taken hold. Projects started and then they closed, meaning there was no infrastructure or ecology. So rather than develop an organisation, our pitch was to consider organisational development. We wanted to make room for making, thinking and doing from the perspective of artists and art producers in the region. So if we were to invent a place, what would it look like? How would we get there? Why would we want to take part? What should we call it? Midwest. The project was designed, I would say, kind of strongly influenced by participatory action research. And overall, we took a lot of guidance from soft systems methodology thinking, which comes from primarily, I think, well, we were drawing primarily on the work of Peter Checkland. Peter Checkland comes from an engineering background. I was really liking his stuff because he draws his ideas. And basically, it's an action learning framework that just gets you to think about when you're going into a situation, to think about how you're establishing your roles, declare your methodology, framework of ideas, and then how it's kind of you're coming out of that and you're reflecting on your experience. So we were thinking about that as a kind of model. That was the sort of basic overall framework we were working with. And I guess this is a drawing of us fiddling around with that as an idea. So it's a way to consider different perspectives of any given situation. Supported by a membership website, the programme worked through a series of events that loosely explored questions that followed on to designing the next. The last question was, can policy be artist-led? At the end of the project, there were around 500 or more Midwest members. There were around 50 artists, primarily from the West Midlands, but also from further afield, that regularly attended the programme, and around 15 that felt like close co-developers of the project. So I think I'm illustrating it was homespun, and some of these images are slightly wonky at times. The project was hands-on. My recollections remind me of feelings of real energy, sociality, real high elation, which I haven't experienced again in the same way since, and extreme tiredness of making sandwiches and getting snacks for what seemed like endless buffet lunches, more about food, and making ideas together. So I really wanted to find a picture of a buffet lunch, but couldn't. But this is a group of us in a chip shop in Glasgow. By coincidence, I sat next to one of the artist co-developers a few weeks ago. She said, "Ooh, Julie Crawshaw. I remember the buffets of Midwest. There was always a good lunch." And at that time, I recalled being in a supermarket, and I think it was in Wolverhampton, which was one of the hotspots of practice we had been asked to consider. And I remember really vividly the handle of the plastic bag really cutting through my hand with all of the sandwiches in it. Rachel lived and still does in a small town called Kidderminster, which is famous for quality carpet manufacturer about 30 minutes outside of Birmingham. Jason commuted from London and I came from Manchester. We would meet at Rachel's dining room table to design Midwest. We rented an office for about 6 months, but gave it up because we never used it. I was aware of being an incomer. I'd set up a gallery and studio group and festivals in Newcastle, in the northeast of England, in the mid to late 90s, but I had no knowledge really of Birmingham or other parts of the region. To scope what was going on and who was out there, we programmed a series of saloons. We used Arts Council England mailing list and started to build our own. Saloons were quite simple in design. We invited a speaker to give a talk, followed by a discussion to survey the interests and concerns of practitioners. The speakers, to be honest, were really just a hook to get people there. We were really more interested in what artists coming wanted to talk about. During the saloons, artists told us that they felt that there was limited recognition of their value. They had limited access to quality studio provision. There was low graduate retention, so students weren't staying in Birmingham or the West Midlands, they were moving away. And there was frustration with an inability for an artist-led infrastructure to be sustained, especially regarding artist-led galleries. What to do next? To consider these issues, we programmed ranches. These were two-day project development workshop sessions. They were designed to facilitate the development of projects, to facilitate thinking. We started to draw on frameworks from international development and also invited artists and curators who had set up smaller organisations to join us and contribute to the workshop facilitation. So some of the kind of frameworks from development studies we were kind of starting to think about and use, and some of these are sort of broader, but I was particularly interested in sort of myself personally kind of studying international development at the time, so it was kind of a way to consider how to pollinate these kind of ideas. So we were kind of using frameworks like this sort of project management triangle that basically is a way to not only just think about what we're going to do, it's a way to sort of pull ourselves away from that and think about how we're going to do it and, more importantly, perhaps why. And problem and solution trees, so mapping problems, thinking about how to therefore make how to make responses to that. And this sustainable livelihoods framework, which was a way of thinking about assets. So it's kind of an asset kind of audit and thinking about how those assets feed into working towards sustainable livelihoods, sustainable development. So rather than replicate any blueprints of how artist-led projects are, for example, as galleries or festivals, we tried to design processes to support the making of room for new ways to manoeuvre. I just really like this slide. It's the hats. So I'm getting that one in. After the ranch events, we went on rodeo trips. We booked buses and trains and went to other cities in the UK, not to replicate what happens, but to explore and share strategies for making things happen. At this time, the Midwest website got to around 150 members. We started to reference a global Midwest community. Some members of the site start to talk about Midwesters. At the end of our two-year contract at our Arts Council funding review, our arts officer asked us to become a regular funded organisation. And I remember us sort of sharing feelings of being unsure a little bit about that invitation. But I'll park that there. This new phase after the review, here's some slides of the website. This new phase included, after this review, an exhibition of recent graduates' work from art schools across the region, when we invited a curator called Michelle Cotton to curate the show of artists of artists graduating, and she called it the best years of our lives. And we continue to develop workshop events to develop project ideas, consider the value of the artist and artist-led practice, and consider practice in relation to regional and national policy development. Chaired by cultural theorist Cobben and Mercer in collaboration with Gallery as a one-day event for Should Black Art Still Be Beautiful, Midwest invited a series of practitioners across fine art disciplines to respond from their individual perspective to the question, what do you see to be the priorities for black cultural practice at this time? For intellectual property, we designed a series of debating forums on economic development, regeneration, and cultural practice to consider different approaches to the notion of workspaces and also looked at the regeneration context of Birmingham, which was developing a new cultural quarter called Eastside at the time, although Birmingham had failed in its bid for European Capital of Culture in 2008, which was awarded to Liverpool. And a number of cities who had bid for that 2008 crown went on to develop other cultural strategies anyway. We brought together economists, urban developers, human geographers, sociologists, urban theorists, and cultural landlords. They were attended by artists, regeneration officers, elected members of local governments, cultural practitioners, cultural strategists, policy makers, sociologists, and art advocates. The next event was called Word of Mouth. We moved outside of the local context here to consider international working, using problem and solution trees like I showed earlier. We discussed the barriers and opportunities towards developing international projects. The final event was called Know Your Place. We asked, can policy be artist-led? A series of practitioners from the West Midlands came together to consider their perspective on policy making and identify key questions which they would then wish to address to policymakers and those who inform the policy and strategy development that subsequently affects the perception of art, artistic practice. We organised a series of visits where we met with policy shapers, including John Holden, who was then head of culture at the think tank Demos in the UK, who was having a big influence on the way that art and culture was being described, and I suppose a big influence on the language that we used to describe it. Beatrice Garcia, who was the head of the research programme to assess the impacts of the Liverpool regeneration programme, and others. And each of the strategy practitioners, so each of these policy people, were then invited to return to the West Midlands to offer offer a presentation that addressed the questions of whether policy could be artist-led. So in effect, they were asked to respond to the conversations they'd had with artists and bring that back to the region to discuss the question further. And a final two-day long event was organised with contributions from Maria Lind and Jerry Hassan. In advance of the next Arts Council England review, Jason, Rachel and myself discussed the future of Midwest. We didn't want to become an organisation. And we told Liz Hawley, who was our Arts Council England officer at the time, that we didn't want the grant. There were artist-led projects emerging, some that had developed through the Midwest process. We suggested money could be distributed to support fledgling initiatives. The idea of self-institution was one of the foundations of the programme, which we had developed together. We listed one of the qualities of self-institution as knowledge, as knowing your own redundancy, and as such, we had to consider our own. To close Midwest, we designed Up, Up and Away as an evaluation event. We invited an experiential learning practitioner to design ways for practitioners to consider and move on from Midwest. As part of the event, myself, Jason and Rachel were interviewed by curator Lisa Lefebvre in front of an audience of Midwesters. During the interview, I had a real sense of sadness and frustration, maybe a sense that something was being taken away. Although the interview was published within the pamphlets that we produced, which to some level were kind of an attempt at a project archive, I couldn't bring myself to read the interview transcript until preparing for today. So Lisa opens the interview by reflecting on her own reading of Midwest. She says, Midwest seems for me an act of generosity that is exemplified by the organisers stepping away from after a period of time to leave the work to be continued by others. Generosity is not a flattering statement, she says. Rather, it is a description of Midwest as a gift to be given to other people to continue and flow through. This generosity is manifest in the conversational nature of Midwest. She continues to ask what is at stake with the demise of the experiment. Rachel, then Jason, then myself answer in turn, and I say, to answer the question about what is at stake with Midwest needs the question, what is Midwest first? I don't think that the disappearance of a pink font and logo means that Midwest no longer exists. Over the last 5 years, I have fallen a little bit in love with many people. And that interaction is, of course, still there. Although the organisation formally no longer exists. Midwest continues because the conversation that because of the conversations that have already happened and because of the peeling back that I have witnessed both in myself and in others through the process of revealing oneself, myself. Once you have taken your pants off, it is a big deal. And I share with you that if I had looked at that, I would have edited that last sentence. As part of my research contribution to the Stretch project, I'm going to reconsider Midwest. The Stretch research asks how artistic practice is constituted, expanded, and stretched within the culture of the artist-led. What can Midwest contribute to this inquiry? When looking through the stuff of Midwest, I am remembered of the colour pink, the loop of a logo, and the contours of a made-up landscape, and some of my experience there. In anthropology and across the arts and social sciences, we no longer understand knowledge as a mirror onto nature for society, but as continually in the making among inhabitants amidst landscapes. In acknowledgement of the interweave between natural conditions and cultural practices, rather than landscape, the cultural geographer John Wiley proposes we should rather think of landscaping, an ongoing process of relating and unrelating. The question of what landscape is or means can always be subsumed in the quest of how it works, what landscape does and what we do in landscape. In the interview transcript, I talk about relating and unrelating. I feel it again as I read it, and even as I speak it now. I talked about a process of revealing oneself, myself. I have fallen in love, I say. To make connections with others, I have undressed. And reading this now, I see I am talking then, I was talking about my experience in the field, of the challenges of being self with others, of feeling close, and of feeling vulnerable. In anthropology, stretching is used to denote where anthropologist and informant are transformed alike mutually. What Lisette Joseph Feeds describes as a meeting of others in a new place through an imperiling of the self. To do so, she warns, to open out to the world, we must take off our masks, and this is a difficult task. The notion of stretching ourselves and landscape will be, for me, paths to follow when considering Midwest and the ongoing design of the stretched research. But for today, what might my exploration of the Midwest landscape offer to our consideration of the commons? It raises questions, of course. We might ask, is the Midwest common land? Was it really made together as a landscape in common? Or perhaps we can more usefully ask this in another way. In John Wiley's terms, did Midwest landscape common relatings? In reading through some of the short reflective texts written by artists, participants in the pamphlets, it looks like it might have. Certainly there is a relational theme in the vocabulary chosen, a culinary artwork, sensuous in its making, bringing us the most exquisite of thinkers from different spheres of academia and practice. Of course, this needs much further consideration. And I won't say too much of this now because there isn't time, but of course to think about, you know, discourses of power and discourses of perhaps performative discourses of thinking about the work of Goffman in terms of when we perform in our everyday, what we are doing on the front of the stage and what we are doing at the back of the stage. Thanks. So returning to the interview with Lisa, I say I don't actually subscribe to Midwest being a generous act at all. It has been a massively selfish activity to put myself in a place where I learn for 5 years. I've had my richest professional experience and I have got paid for it. The generosity is simply based on the time and effort that everybody has put into it. It's important for me to clarify that. The dialogue that the three of us have had, the way we have developed a collaborative practice out of necessity, has responded to the situation. We have tried to be the participant, not the facilitator, in order to make sure the dialogue is not just amongst the three of us. It's important also to note that our position within the project has significantly changed from the point we were three consultants working together. And along the way to where we are today, I feel I have become a part of a community of inquiry, a part of a generous extended family. The process has massively influenced the way I think and work. Within the complex terrain of value, the anthropologist Marilyn Strathern sees value as a matter of making visible. Social relations take on value in the process of being recognised by someone else. Through a process of relating and unrelating, perhaps the value of Midwest is in making visible the terrain in order to consider it anew. Midwest's process of landscaping common relatings produced recognition of space for opportunity. A sort of in-between space for thinking and doing. We made it together through questions, trying to avoid not to go straightly to what we want to do, but think about why and how we might get there. At the time, Beatrice Garcia was the lead researcher of the Impact of Liverpool 08, and Beatrice made a contribution to one of our publications in terms of responding to this question of can policy be artist-led? At the time, the dichotomy between a highly regulated policy language and the organic and ever-changing language of the art seems to suggest a barrier and difficulty for the artist to communicate with and influence the policy world. However, the act of policymaking is not only the result of highly deliberate practices. Decision-making and policy also results out of ad hoc decisions in an inconsistent basis, responding to public or political pressure. Performativity rather than constativity characterises policy. Artists can thus influence policymaking if they are able to create the kinds of pressure that policymakers can overlook. In order to achieve this, artists should act as an organised group, as opinion leaders, representing the needs of a community. This is because the policymaker will respond to requests that are placed on behalf of a common good, rather than individual demands and aspirations. In order to act as an organised group, artists should thus work towards finding a common ground, learning to lobby. In other words, they should act as brokers, protecting practice beyond particular interests. So I'm just going to do like a cat in a basket turn around, because this is my last bit. Julie, why is this relevant? How do I think this contributes to our conversation? I have used landscape, I think, as a relational lens. And I wanted sort of thinking on our kind of panel this morning, drawing on comments from the panel discussion, environmental metaphors can be unhelpful. So we use metaphors like the ecology, the landscape, and sustainability. But of course, these big words, for example, Isabel Stengers, who's a philosopher of multiplicity, she talks about bullet points. And she asks us to try and move away from these bullet points, these loud words. Because of course, they can close doors as well as open windows to new horizons. So I do not offer landscape as a picture to look at, but as a reminder that we are being humans in land and sea. And in the case of Midwest under a starry sky and the moon, which may or may not have a vulture flying overhead. In Leandro's terms of earlier, we are a network of networks. Sustainability is a term used for the holistic process of considering environmental, social, and and economic perspectives together. It is not a bullet point that shouts, keep going, but is a nuanced conversation calling for the consideration of why and how to continue. I'm going to leave it there. Thank you very much.